Thing, everybody.
One of them is Nan. I already saw.
Oh, great. But you want to introduce us?
Yeah. Welcome, everybody. It's been a little while ago since we've done this. But do we have a really great interview in store for you today? This man is an absolute legend in the recording industry. He has recorded over 2,000 movie scores. A short insight on TV main titles that this man is on. For example, Dukes of Hazzard, Love Boat, Dynasty, $6 Million Man, Knight Rider, Starsky and Hutch. Movie scores are Rocky II, Rocky III, LA Confidential. And then he also had a career with live jazz artists such as Doc Severinsen, Zoot Sims, Sarah Vaughan, Pat Williams. The list is pretty much endless with this man. So Josh and I with the West Coast Jazz Hour would like to welcome Steve Schaeffer today to our show.
I'd like to meet the guy that you're talking about.
Thanks for having us, Steve.
Oh, my pleasure.
Yeah.
My pleasure.
And we're doing this live from your home studio.
Yes, we had to avoid the building that's going on next to yours.
Yes, I don't have quite the quiet setup as you do. So thank you for welcoming
us
to your beautiful home. And just getting a chance to hang out with you and check out some music and some video and talk about your career. Really looking forward to it.
Sounds good.
Looking forward
to it.
Yeah, and it's extensive, everybody.
Most likely will be a two-parter.
Yeah. So
allow us.
Yeah, hang on to your hats. So we should start with the beginning. You want to, you know, acknowledge a couple of folks.
Sure. Born and raised in New York City. Born in Brooklyn. Raised in Queens from the age of 7. Educated in New York. So. Growing up in Queens, it was the three children, my parents and my brother, who's passed during COVID, and my sister, who's still with us, Ruth Ann. Hi, Ruth Ann. And lots of family back east right now. Anyway, started piano lessons at 9 years old and wound up with a couple of different piano teachers. The second one, his name was Charles P. Ragusa, a very strict Italian piano teacher who told my mother that I didn't want to play the piano, but I wanted to play the drums. And he had another student whose name was Bob Mann. Hi, Bob, if you're listening. Mm-hmm. And my mother called his mother and we got together. I had a drum set in the basement. Mm-hmm. And we became friends. We're still friends. And I like to acknowledge my other good friends that I grew up with, which are Bob Mann, of course, Alan Rubin, who's passed, Alan Schwartzberg, and Andy Muson, and also Marty Morell. Those were the guys who I grew up with. And then playing up in the Catskill Mountains and things like that, I met all these other great musicians. And of course, they're part of my history. My friends Andy and Alan Schwartzberg, Andy Muson and Alan Schwartzberg, we still communicate weekly, if not daily. And they're great musicians. Alan's a great drummer and played on a lot of amazing hit records. Andy is a great bass player who's not playing anymore, but he was a musical director for the Manhattan Transfer and also for Bette Midler. Mm. And Bob is still playing and he writes arrangements and co-produces stuff with Chief Steve Tyrell for Rod Stewart and a bunch of albums that they've done. And so he's a fantastic musician. And so those guys are still in my life and I love them dearly. So then on to, you know, I had a great teacher, Stanley Krell. Was my first teacher, and he sent me on to Morris Goldenberg, who became a teacher and mentor. He was also a teacher for the great Shelley man, mm-hmm. and for Alvin Stoller. They mm-hmm. grew up in New York, and the dots all connect because Shelley Mann became one of my mentors, and I'll get to that. So let's see. Early experiences, Marshall Brown's Newport Youth Band. Mm. I was not quite 14. I wanted to be part of the band. This friend, Alan Rubin, who I grew up with, had graduated from that band, and it was a band put together of the best young musicians in the tri-state area, tri-state being New York, New Jersey, and Connecticut. Mm. And a lot of the players on the band you might know were Micah Benny. He played piano. Mm-hmm. Herb Mickman was the first bass player. Eddie Gomez was playing when I got into the training band. He was the regular bass player. Ronnie Cuber and Harry Hall, Nat Favone. A lot of players that went on to play with Maynard Ferguson and mm-hmm. not with us anymore, but I'm missing a few. But and the teachers that ran that program became the teachers at the Berklee School of Music. They were the founders of Berklee School of Music. Mm-hmm. John LaPorter, Lou Mucci, I think the main two that I can remember. In any event, from there, I played with Al Cohn and Zoot Sims.
That was your first band.
That was a band, you know, of famous guys.
Yeah.
And I got the job in between 1964 and 65. I was really young, and I was 19, and I was playing at the Half Note. I played weekends, but I had two bands, so I got to play opposite John Coltrane and all these amazing musicians that I could listen to. I remember my friend Bob and I went to see Wes Montgomery, and his drummer at that time was Melvin Ryan on organ, and he had a trio, and the drummer was George Brown. He didn't show for the first set, and I wound up playing with Wes, and my friend Bob said I looked like a deer in the headlights.
Yeah, yeah.
But playing with Al Cohn and Zoot Sims, they were amazing teachers to me. Mm. Zoot would take me home and play. He said, "Do you know how to play a Lunsford II?" I said, "Well, I know how to play in two." He says, "Well, you got to learn how to play a Lunsford II for me." And he would take me home to his house and play records, you know, Fletcher Henderson and the Jimmy Lunsford band. And Jimmy Crawford was the drummer.
Yeah.
I learned how to do that. I also would go down to New York whenever I had a second into Manhattan. I would take the bus and train and stand outside the Metropole and listen to all these great musicians. Most of the time on the weekends during the day, they had more of Dixieland type players. Mm-hmm. And I met Zooty Singleton. And I had listened to my father's collection of the Louis Armstrong Hot 5 and Hot 7. So I knew his playing. And believe it or not, it came in handy much later in my life when I had to play in the movies. And they would say, "Do you know how to play this style?" And I said, "Yes, I do." And so all those early experiences turned out to be fantastic for me as far as my career. Mm. having played in the Catskills and stuff, I met Herb Mickman, who I mentioned earlier. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And he was working with Sarah Vaughan. Well, actually, digress for a second. Mm-hmm. Alan Rubin was playing for this act, Robert Goulet. He'd just gotten off Broadway. Marty Morell, who was a friend, he was the drummer. He left to join Bill Evans. And I got the call to join Robert Goulet and travel. And, you know, and that was a great experience. I'm losing my trend, but all those experiences turned out to be really valuable in the career that I never thought I'd have, being a studio musician, because I really wanted to be a jazz musician. Mm. And I tried very hard, and I played with a lot of great players back there. And we have, actually, you have a tape. I joined Howard McGee's big band,
mm-hmm.
and it great was made of great. I remember I met Lanny Morgan, who I wound up working with here. And the saxophone section in that band was Sonny Red. Well, Lanny Morgan lead, Sonny Red, Jimmy Heath, Clifford Jordan, and Shahib Shahab. That was the saxophone section. Nat Pavone played lead trumpet. Harry Hall was on the band, which were guys from the Newport Youth Band.
Mm-hmm.
And then he had some, like, I think it was Lamar Wright. I didn't know them. They were famous trumpet players that had played in a lot of bands, you know, Duke Ellington and Basie. And he had Garnett Brown and Melba Liston, Benny Green.
Frank Rehack was in that
Frank
band too.
Frank Rehack one time, yeah. The bass player was Gene Taylor, who was the bass player with Horace Silver. Mm-hmm. And he used a piano player named Andy Bay, who sang and played piano. Yes.
Andy Bay.
So we went to the Newport Jazz Festival. We played some gigs and we played at the Newport Jazz Festival in 1966. And we put our stuff back on the bus. We were going to go back to New York City. And this trumpet conclave came out. And Dizzy Gillespie was the main star of that. And they had all these great trumpet players, Clark Terry, Kenny Durham, Thad Jones, Jimmy Owens, Ruby Braff, Bobby Hackett, and Dizzy. And so they asked me to stay. For the bass player was Gene Taylor and myself. We had to join Kenny Burrell and Billy Taylor to make up the rhythm section. And then the thing started. No rehearsals. Couldn't get my drums because they were on the bus already. And so they had this little ratty set with one tom-tom and one 17-inch ride cymbal, and the bass drum had no spur to stop it from moving. So there's a video if you'd like to.
We should totally watch that.
To see of that band. Yeah. We don't have to play the whole thing, but sure. It showed up 50 years after. It was something I looked for years to see because people didn't believe I did that.
Which
so it's under, just in the main file there. It says down towards the bottom, it'll say there.
Trumpet and Guitar Workshop.
Trumpet and Guitar Workshop.
Okay. From the beginning?
Sure. They introduce what's happening. And we're going to bring the... You can turn down the sound on that knob there. No, on that one. Yeah, that's the main knob, a little bit.
All of the trumpet men have been out back once more. And as we said earlier, we're trying to show the similarities as well as the differences in performance. So I think this time you'll really get a chance to have us make our point, or help us make our point.
Thank you. We'll be right back. Jimmy Owens on the trumpet here. Clark Terry. Bobby Hackett. Thad Jones. Hal McGee. Kenny Durham. Ruby Braff. Dizzy Gillespie. Kenny Burrell. Jim Schaeffer. Billy Taylor.
And remember when that somebody let me know it was out, and I said, "Oh my God, I wonder if that tempo held." You know, from because it's forever.
It
you know,
did,
and it did, and so yeah, I was so happy about that.
Yeah, that's freaking poignant.
So yeah, that was. It was something that, you know, people said, you know, well, you never played with Dizzy Gillespie. I said, no, I actually played with him. It wasn't like I sat in or something. I actually played with the guy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, not regularly or anything. And no, and I couldn't ever prove it.
Yeah. Yeah.
But then the tape showed up 50 years later.
Yeah.
Wow. So
we're like, here, hello. So,
yeah. It was made by a Boston news company. That's why it's not good quality. And but it was really a milestone, you know,
yeah,
to play in that band and everything.
Sure. So, legends.
Yeah.
It sounds good. Like that. It's nice to hear you a bit up front in the mix.
Playing, I never played on a high pitched cymbal like that, you know, but it was a small cymbal. But
you made it sound good.
Well, it was okay. So, anyway, from that. Let's see. So, and of course, Al and Zoot, I said they were my mentors. And I remember that Al Cohn sent me to, he said, I want you to go to my teacher. I said, your teacher, you know, he said, yeah, Hall Overton was his teacher at, he taught privately, but he also was the head of composition at Juilliard for a long time. So I went to his studio and his little anecdote. He said, I need to test your ears. I never forgot this. And I said, okay, so how do you do that? And he said, I'm going to play an orchestral hit, just the hit. And I want you to go to the piano and tell me what you hear. So this, he put on a record and then the orchestral hit happened. Okay. And then of course I heard, you know, the trumpets first, and so I went over and I found the note that it was. He says, well, okay, you have your hearing is treble oriented, and so we need to work on your opening up your ears. So he gave me a Horace Silver record, ironically, you know. And I guess Gene Taylor was on that too, but and he said, I want you to take the bass lines down. And I don't want you to come back until you have the bass lines to these two tunes. And it was interesting because later, as I matured, when I worked with great musicians, I would ask them, like Larry Bunker and I became really good friends. And more about Larry, but I asked him how he heard, and he's a self-taught musician. Mm. And he said he hears from the bottom up. That's why he was such a great timpani player, aside from everything else that he played. And so I used to ask him if I could just borrow his ears for just one day so I could hear the way he did. And of course, he couldn't give them to me, but you know, I tried to improve in my listening to do that. But I guess I was always more treble oriented. I don't know about you guys, but it's
yeah,
you know, when you talk to somebody, my friend Bob, has relative perfect pitch, so he could write an arrangement in a car without anything. But so he has those kind of ears, but I never did. Developed other talents, but not that. Anyway, it's interesting.
Yeah, sure is.
How does this lead on to?
So playing with Alan Zoot, of course, that was, and having them as mentors, which is what we're talking about basically, and connecting the dots. So from there, I got a call one day from Herb Mickman and asking me that Sarah was revamping her trio. Bob James had left, and that he and she wanted to replace the drummer that was there. And so he hired Chick Corea and myself to join Sarah. That was in 1967. And the first job was at the Fairmont Hotel in San Francisco. So Chick and I joined, and I had had a relationship with him, not so much playing in bands with him, but he subbed for me once on drums. He was a really great musician. And then one time I came in late to it, he was playing the drums, and then he moved over to the piano. And he sounded a lot like Bud Powell and McCoy Tyner, which a lot of people might not know, but I mean, that was two of his greatest influences. And we recorded while we did shows in Las Vegas. Was our second job, and in 1968 that we actually recorded, he did we did just a recording from the piano, so you could hear the vocals, you could hear the bass and drums. It's not a perfect recording, it wasn't a record, but it was something that we wanted to just hear how we sounded. And so he gave me a copy of the tape, which I had until it was, my apartment was robbed, and then somebody else helped me get copies of what I had already had. So I don't know if you want to segue to that.
I'd love to share,
want to play something from that.
Absolutely.
And the Sarah who he's talking about is Sarah Vaughan. Yes. Everybody.
Yeah. And if you're just joining us, we're with just recording legend and drummer extraordinaire Steve Schaeffer, live from his beautiful studio in LA here, and just spending some time with them, learning about his history. And now we're moving to the late 60s with Sarah Vaughan.
Yes, 67, 68.
Yeah. Okay.
And 69, I was with her for those like 2.5 years.
Okay.
And it's on my Apple Music.
Oh, it's on Apple.
So it's you have it at the bottom there, and so I think which
would you like to play?
Maybe Day In Day Out.
That's a good way. So this was never, I mean, like you said, it wasn't ever recorded for a release. So this is pretty exclusive.
Exclusive. Yeah, very exclusive.
You're sharing this with everybody.
Yes,
it's pretty cool.
I'm the only surviving member of that group, actually.
Yeah.
So.
Wow.
It was a very meaningful time for me, a tremendous growth period. I learned a lot. I used to hang out with Chick, and we played chess. We talked about music. And I helped him at that period of time. He was editing his record with Roy Haynes and Miroslav Vidos, which was Now He Sings, Now He Sobs. And I helped put together, cut together the, he needed the outtake from after Roy's solo. He liked the front part, but he wanted the back part of another take. And I had to find, I found a lick that Roy played that I could, we did it, you know, with a little, with a razor blade and everything, you know, on a Wolinsack tape recorder to just see if we could put it together. And it worked fine. And that actually became the cut in the thing. And was, and so
wow,
people don't know about that,
but that's a very cool story. Oh my gosh, so this is pretty cool, everybody. We're gonna play Sarah Vaughan with Chick Corea, Herb McMahon, and Steve Schaeffer, day in, day out. Isn't right. that? Okay.
And this is in Vegas?
Las Vegas, the Riviera Hotel.
Riviera.
Yeah, Starlight Theater. They had a little lounge thing there.
Right, here we go.
Possibility of baby being come rain, come shine. I need you enter me the day and I kiss your lips. The pounding becomes the ocean draw. A thousand drums, can't you see it's love? Can there be any doubt when there is?
Pretty so great trio.
Yeah.
And just to hear, I'm such a fan of that Now He Sings, Now He Sobs record, as so many pianists and artists are, just to hear his vocabulary from that period coming through with Sarah, with you, it's very hip, you know.
Yeah, maybe you didn't realize it was at the same time.
Yeah.
It was
right in the same time. Yeah.
Yeah.
Just fantastic. Did you guys work up the book with her? Did you have rehearsals? Was it
pretty? We had some rehearsals, but we rehearsed. I remember at the Fairmont during the day when we got there. I don't remember if we had a rehearsal before that. We might not have.
Pretty quick, put the show together.
Yeah, we put the show together. We were. It was really a high level gig. It might have been one of the most desirable jazz gigs ever. When I left, Jimmy Cobb took my place and stayed for 8 years.
Wow. Oh, my God.
Yeah. It was the one of the few jazz gigs that paid a retainer. It wasn't a lot, but it was enough. It didn't pay a lot of money. It was paid like maybe $325 a week, but we got like $125 a week when we didn't work. And so we were able to do other stuff, you know, but we always had to be on call.
Right.
And when we traveled, we always got rooms. Like the Miles Davis band, those guys made about $200 a week and they had to pay their own motel. You know, it's kind of crazy, but, you know, working at the Half Note, for example, only paid $70 a weekend. So I couldn't afford to garage a car in New York to carry my drums. It was hard. It was really hard to think about making a living as a jazz musician.
Yeah.
There are famous jokes about that. Lester Young once asked a drummer to go to Buffalo or someplace and he'd have to drive his own car. And he said he could pay him like, you know, something ridiculous low. He says, well, why? He said, well, you got to save up for them gigs, you know. But,
wow.
You know, didn't pay a lot of money compared to other jobs. When I, you know, had the job with Robert Goulet, it paid $500 a week, which was a lot of money then.
Yeah.
Sure.
But playing with her was amazing. And she was the nicest person, sweet, nice, and great to the musicians, mm-hmm. and liked to hang with them. And she was a good pianist. She yeah. played with Earl Father Hines Band.
Mm-hmm.
And she used to tell me that the drummer was Art Blakey,
mm-hmm.
and that nobody's feet were touching the ground when he shuffled, mm-hmm. when he would play a shuffle. He said it was, everybody was like just floating, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I always remember that. And she treated me great. She never wow. really told me how to play, never criticized or anything. I mean, she left it to me to find my place. And I know that when Jimmy Cobb came in, he played... It wasn't a soft drummer, you know, and somebody complained to her in the audience and would tell the drummer to play softer. And she said, if that's Jimmy Cobb, I'm not telling him anything. So.
Who were some of your influences at that time from that recording? Because you mentioned Philly Joe to me, but that at that time, you sound like a combination between Philly and 60s Tony, I would say.
Well, the Tony influenced me, of course, and of course Jimmy Cobb did, because, you know, I wanted to play with Miles Davis, so I wanted to be able to play in the style of but have my own voice. But yes, I was influenced by and Roy Haynes, of course.
Mm-hmm.
And
I hear that sort yeah, of yeah, yeah.
And there was a drummer named Pete LaRocca who was a big yeah. influence on me. They never captured him the way it sounded in live to me.
Really?
Yeah. But he had chances to play with the people that he wanted to play his own music. And Chick was a good friend of his. And I used to go to hear him play all the time. And he was a great Latin player.
Mm-hmm.
He changed his name from Peter Sims to Pete LaRocca. So we, not that it's a Latin name, but he was a really, really great timbali player.
Mm-hmm.
And he played on a lot of like Latin jazz bands. So, okay, where are we now?
Yeah, where does it go? Is so, your travel to LA? Is this?
Well, I went with Sarah. I actually went with Doc Severinsen once to play in Melody Land, but that was in 1964,
65. Was that a big band thing?
No, it was a small group.
Oh.
And just briefly, I don't know how we're doing time-wise, but...
We're doing fine.
Great.
So I had been playing with Alan Zoot and this drummer, Bobby Rosengarten, who was the main drummer on The Tonight Show, later became the leader of the Dick Cavett band show. He heard me play, and Ed Shaughnessy was the second drummer on The Tonight Show, and he traveled with Doc. Bobby left to go with Dick Cavett, so Ed became the main drummer. He couldn't travel because Doc left the show. He thought he was going to be the leader, but they hired Milton DeLug, and that became a different situation. So Bobby recommended me to Doc, and they were good friends, and so I got the gig. I was 19, mm-hmm. and you know, I had to play first. He had to like what he heard. And so went to California. Then it was my first shot at California. Then with Sarah, we used to play at Century Plaza Hotel.
Oh, at Fairmont.
The Century Plaza Hotel. It wasn't a Fairmont. It was, I forgot what the room was called, but there was a room there. They had the Hong Kong bar, but that was, we played the main room.
Mm-hmm.
And, it was great, and we had, you know, we had hotel rooms there at the Century Plaza Hotel, and
that's the one on the west side. Yeah.
And then when I was in Vegas, when Chick left, she got other players, and then we had Reggie Johnson on bass, but she hired a piano player named Charles Coleman, and then he left. No, he didn't leave at that time, but Reggie left, and she had a friend named Gus Mancuso, who was a baritone horn player in Vegas, to play the bass. And I don't know, I met somebody else that I was romantically involved with, and I left the band at that time because it wasn't the same kind of band as what we just heard. And nothing was like that band. I don't think she ever had a band that was that articulate, you know? I mean,
yeah,
and could go off in places that she had never been to before.
Absolutely.
And so she had good, great musicians, you know, who became my friends, Bill Mays and Carl Schroeder and those kind of guys, but nothing like Chick, you know.
Right.
So great. Anyway, so I came out to California here, and I was doing a rehearsal. Shelly Mann, this is a great little anecdote thing. I'm playing at the Union, the old Union, and there was, before it was fixed up even years ago, but there was an outdoor room. It looked like a little door on the outside, and I was playing with a band there. I think the band was Joe Roccasano's. It was called Transfusion, and had some really good players in it. David Foster was the keyboard player. Jay Graydon was the guitar player. David Hungate was the bass player, and a lot of really good players. And I came out of the rehearsal, and Shelly Mann said, "Hey, kid," he said, "you sound great." He said, "Listen, you interested in, I'm working with this band with Lorinda Almeida. I forgot what it was called, the something
LA4. Four,
LA4. Four. He said, "I got to go out of town. Will you play in my band?" And it was Mike Wofford, John Morell, Jeff O'Castleman was the bass player, John Gross, and Gary Barone.
Mm-hmm.
And
Mike Barone's brother.
Yep. And I played that weekend, and really it was a great experience. I couldn't tell you how thrilled I was
with
this man to ask me to play for him,
right,
in his band at his club. I mean, it was like, I figured this is going to be so great for me. And nothing happened from the job, except I had a great relationship with Mike Wofford and played with his band, and we played some gigs together and did various things. And in any event, it took, but Shelly, we stayed friendly, and then I went back to New York. I played with Willie Bobo's band for a minute out here, and wow. And I was traveling with the woman I married, whose name was Fran Jeffries, and that marriage ended, and I went back to New York to play a gig, and was discovered. I got the show A Chorus Line, to come back to LA with The Chorus Line, and I'm playing at the Schaeffer Theater.
Oh wow!
And it was a great band.
That was when the show was new.
The show, it was the original Broadway cast. Terry Trotter was one of the pianists.
Oh, Terry.
And a guy named John Berkman. And my friend Andy Muson played bass. Another bass player, Don Baldwin, a really good bass player. And it had Gene Cipriano would sub. Jack Nimitz was baritone player on the band. Joe Lopes, Vic Morosco, Earl Dumbler was regular in the band. Long story short, the contractor liked me a lot, hired me to play a gig for Pat Williams at Warner Brothers. I went in there. The engineer loved the drums. Was vocal to me how much he enjoyed it, which is the major connection, is the sound with the end. If you have a thing with the engineer, otherwise your career's over immediately. Pat Williams liked it. John Guerin was his main drummer. Liked it. I got a call like in a week later that, how fast can you get down to the studio? They were doing the main title of the Bob Newhart Show. So I played the main title. I had heard the show, but I mean, I didn't have a chance to prepare my head for that. I didn't know what the music looked like or anything like that.
Right.
And it was a complex, funky kind of main title. And we have that here, which became really important because Larry Bunker, now a guy who had heard me sub like on Mike Barone's band and stuff, he's with me with Pat Williams. He's the main percussionist that Pat hired on all of his work. So now I'm playing, and John Guerin was one of my favorite drummers. Now I'm playing his chair, and I did a really great job. I thought, you know, I mean, they told me I did a great job anyway. I thought I did a good job. And then
I think so
Pat,
too.
Pat started using me for things. And I mean, you can play the main title. I have it on the it's on the drive, the
right here, Bob Newhart thing.
Yeah, that's it.
Right. Sharing audio. Yeah. By the way, this is one of my favorite TV shows. I'm an old, so I love old TV. Old.
This was one of my favorite main titles.
Great main title.
Yeah, incredible.
And I had no idea it was you.
Well, the very original one was not, and Kevin listened to the difference. This became a really a funkier thing. Yeah. You'll hear it. Okay. It's not as hi-hat oriented.
Right. Okay. Here we go with Bob Newhart thing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You just have to. Highlight it and hit spacebar. Right? Yeah.
Is watching. Hey, Greg. He says it's Sonny Burke on keys. long theme.
Well, they
plenty to use.
This is the big one, yeah.
To know, like, you get to the studio, like, you know, super last minute, and is there any conversation between you and Pat about what he wants for the drum part? Because this is not your normal, like, ding, ding, got to do. This is like a drum and bass type of thing.
Yeah. You heard the original.
That's what
different. Yeah.
John Garen.
I kind of like had an idea once he played me the old one. Right. Had an idea.
Well, there you go.
And then I said, okay, well, you know, but I'm not going to do that.
Mm-hmm.
So how does this sound?
And yeah.
He didn't have much to say to me about that. He, you know, he either liked it or he didn't like it.
Yeah.
But, he didn't nitpick any of that kind of thing at all. Just had to figure out. I kind of gelled well with the bass, and I have to tell you that, you know, I got to work with Chuck Rainey on part of that Singers Unlimited. Pat hired him to do some of that on the funky stuff.
Yeah, yeah.
And I didn't get a lot of work playing jazz in the studios. It was more playing the other kind of thing, you know. To answer your question, and I had to have, you know, get drums that suited that. My 18-inch bass drum, wide open, was not going to be for that kind of thing.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But, you know, so when we first went and played this thing at this TTG studio, this recording of it was made at, this became the main part of the main title, but there's another recording, which I think you heard here. That was made up, it's not as good a quality. So Pat recorded this separately.
Right.
And those are my drums as opposed to, John's drums.
Mm.
That I had to play on the first one.
Mm-hmm.
But the part was the same, you know what I mean?
Okay. And this was pretty much the job that sort of moved you.
Well, this started working with him.
Yeah.
You know, because he needed somebody versatile. And Larry and I got along really good. And I could, well, mostly I was playing drums for him. I wasn't playing percussion. Mm. But later that became that I could move over and play percussion because I had the training to do that. I think I mentioned that.
Well, the intersection for me with Garen, John Garen, was, I think I mentioned to you, I played in Mike Barone's big band for a couple years. And it was the year right before John died, 2004.
Right.
And Kevin knows because we've talked about this, but just people that were really important to me when I was in my, that was my early 20s, with John Garen and Jack Sheldon. I got to play in Jack's band for a little while.
Name drop.
Yeah, I mean, these were the guys, but Garen was so supportive and sweet to me.
Yep.
And he would, you know, we're playing and you just look over and say, sound good, kid. And I'll never forget that. And I think Garen is one of those people that on this show with Kevin, it's been kind of this thread of someone that, like yourself, was able to kind of move from into jazz and then, you know, from jazz into studio work and kind of navigate.
Right.
I
could recognize him on a lot of records. I could tell right away it was him when he played for O.C. Smith and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And it was really influential to me also. And he was such a great musician and a big loss, you know.
Yeah.
But I wound up getting a lot of this work more about as the sounds changed and the techno stuff changed. They needed newer stuff I don't know how John felt about that, but I wound up, you know, doing most of that kind of work mm-hmm. that maybe he would have had if it was a different period of time.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And then you become the fashionable color of the month or whatever you want to call it.
Right.
Stuff snowballs, you know. It's interesting how that works. And also, I was very reliable. I always was there early on my jobs. Always got sounds for the engineer, made sure that they were happy, because otherwise the date would get held up.
Yeah.
And if the engineer didn't like they're sitting next to the composer, you know, in the playbacks.
Yeah.
It's like, you're not there.
Yeah. Oh,
man, drums don't sound good. You know, oh, that shit, it's over for you.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah.
So I became very conscious of sound.
Mm.
That was part of my ear the sound of what do you think the guy wants to hear? What, how do you get into somebody's head? Right. As an accompanist, you have the same, it's the same situation.
Absolutely.
I mean, see, Chick Corea would not be good for certain singers because he would just do his thing, you know, and it's like Sarah Vaughan, well, she has perfect pitch. So
he could do anything.
Yeah, he could do anything.
Yeah.
She knew where she was.
Yeah.
And maybe she'd forget the lyric because she was so busy listening to what he was, where, what the hell's going on? But as he played himself,
right,
and I came to the conclusion that I have to play myself, but I have to play what the person wants, because if I just go do my thing, that's not his thing
mm-hmm.
or her thing. It becomes so as a studio player, I didn't have like I had an identity. I didn't realize it. I did have an identity, but I didn't realize it. I was more of a chameleon. I would have to play in lots of different styles and fit into the thing and make sure that I had a really good sound and the time was really good.
Yeah.
And so, you know, other guys that could be recognized quickly, that doesn't always work to have an identifiable person to fit in with somebody who's trying to do, if they wanted to sound like the average white band and you're playing, you know, like Tony Williams, that's not going to work out. It's not going to sound right.
Right.
So,
so knowing what's right sonically, what's right stylistically for each job.
Everything became, I guess that was my identity.
Absolutely. Wow.
So, Larry Bunker. I get the job. I'm working with Pat Williams. Okay, I do the Bob Newhart show. Fantastic.
Mm-hmm.
I'm doing some of other stuff for Pat. Along comes a main title, Hawaii 5-0.
Mm-hmm.
The contractor at CBS. It's Morty Stevens, yeah,
famous.
Head of
so
music.
An arranger,
Well, he wasn't the contractor, but the contractor calls Larry Bunker, who's the percussionist, big band orchestra, Artie Kane playing piano, Tommy Tedesco, Dennis Buttermeier, Chuck DeMonico, Larry, you know, you name it, and Morty Stevens. John Guerin's was the drummer who did the original Hawaii 5-0. So they said, Larry, I can't get a drummer. I've called every first call drummer in town. Everybody's busy. The town was jumping. Larry says, hire Steve Schaeffer. Now he's worked with me. He heard me play and under pressure in situations. He's heard me play. He knows I can read, you know, and all that stuff.
Yeah.
The guy's name was Herman Berardinelli. He said, I don't know him, Larry. How am I going to hire somebody I don't know? My job's on the line. I got to hire a first call player, you know, to come in. Larry says, hire Steve Schaeffer. Herman says, Larry, if I hire a guy I don't know, I may lose my job. He said, and then I'll get, you know, fired. And Larry said, if you don't like it, give me the bill.
Wow.
What, you know, that's tens of thousands of dollars for a main title at CBS Radford. You know, it's like, oh my God. And Herman, I supposedly said, what do you mean? He said, you hire him. If they're not happy, give me the bill and you'll have them, you won't lose anything. Okay, so he hires me. So I wind up going in on Hawaii 5-0. I won't tell you the adjectives that Morty Stevens was screaming mm-hmm. when he saw me walking on because he thought he had John Guerin. Mm-hmm. And I won't say that stuff, but so I go into the booth. Tommy Tedesco says, no pressure, kid. You know? and I played it slightly faster that year. I played it well. And when I finished, now all these writers that show up, of course, Morty Stevens was there. Bruce Broughton was there. Jerry Immel. Who had Dallas and Knott's Landing and all these other shows. Don Ray, John Elizalde, all these writers for CBS and their shows were there because they all show up because Morty Stevens was the head of music at CBS. Mm-hmm. And now I'm like, I don't know what to do because now all these guys want to use me on their shows. Mm-hmm. It was like a snowball effect.
Yeah.
And that's how those main titles started happening. And it wasn't anything I said or did. It's just what happened. And it took a mentor. It was Larry Bunker. I will be forever grateful to him for putting his head on a chopping block. Mm. Now, how many people would do that? Probably no one, you know.
Yeah.
And the other person was Shelley Mann, who now heard me play on some of these things. He knew me as a jazz player.
Yeah, right.
Now he hears me do this stuff. And Joe Porcaro told me he was going crazy. Man, you know, he loved what he was hearing. And so he calls me and invites me down to RCA Hyder's. And I go in there with him. And it was Henry Mancini movie. And he brings me in the booth and he says, Hank, this is Steve Schaeffer. I want you to hire him and put him on the job for tomorrow. We were doing Victor Victoria. And he said, and I said, I didn't know. Mm-hmm. I didn't know what this was about. And so Henry Mancini says, okay, Shelley, fine. And then the engineer said, what time can you have your drums here? I want to get, you know, and so do that. And I had my drums at the studio. And now, you know, I'm working with him. A person really took it upon himself because he heard this kind of thing that he heard on a main title like that and said, okay, we need to get this guy, you know, going here. And so now I'm working for Dave Grusin. I'm working for Henry Mancini. I have a video there. You can put up from there's a one or two things it's on the drive.
Yeah, that's great.
It's a TV special.
TV special.
Yeah.
And so it's under Henry Mancini folder, and then it's the you can do Fallout maybe.
Is it Live the Pink Panther theme?
There's that, but Fallout, it's above it. It says Pete Condoli, Fallout.
Fallout, there it is.
Yeah. That's Chuck DeMonico who starts off this tune. And you don't have to play the whole thing. We can fade it out, but just, and you can open it up a little bit. Yeah. That's the one with the bass, yeah. Okay. Thank you. that, but we don't have to show, you know, we're trying to consolidate some of
this. Yeah.
So when Shelley died, I became his drummer.
Yeah.
Prior to that, I mean, Frank Capp did do some live playing with him.
Yeah.
But in the studio, not that I know of anyway, but Shelley did, was his guy.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
And so that connection in Larry, between Shelley and Larry, that's how, when Shelley died, aside from Henry Mancini, Jerry Goldsmith needed a guy that could play orchestral snare drum and play drums. And Shelley was always his guy. And so, and Shelley was a student of Billy Gladstone's.
Mm-hmm.
So he had a lot of, he's a beautiful snare drum player. Mm-hmm. And so I started working for, well, I did for Henry, and you have that track, you know, from Bolero, We Don't Need to Play That, from the movie 10.
Yeah.
And we also have with Goldsmith. So Larry told Jerry to hire me. I had played for him once before, but it was electronics. And but to play it on his movies regularly, he had a small percussion section. It's usually 4 or 5 maximum. Larry was the timpanist. He had Emil Richards playing mallets. Shelley played the drum stuff, the snare drum and whatever. And he had Gary Coleman, who was a friend of his that was in the Wrecking Crew, his percussionist. And then when I joined, after I joined, we had Alan Estes come in and play also if they needed a fifth player.
Yeah.
And or Joe Picaro.
Wow. Wow.
So so how it all, the dots all connect. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? It's like,
yeah,
from 0 to 100, you know, over a period of a few years.
I mean, yeah. Jerry Goldsmith fan. Any favorite films that you remember doing
all of them? But I mean, the snare drum parts, what do I have there on under Goldsmith, on that drive? Do I have anything there? Yeah, both the one from the one from Marshall's, U.S. Marshall's sinking, the was sinking plan. No, it's right up there. No, it's there.
Sinking plan.
There, yeah. But that I played on LA Confidential. There's some drums, but
that's a great score.
Yeah,
I don't have that on my playlist. Okay.
So this is
just snare drum.
Yeah.
And also Marshall. An Air Force. Yeah, and the Air Force One is really some serious snare drum.
Can we play this one, sinking plane.
Yeah, just for a minute. Okay. You can just you can hear the.
Yeah.
I have to. I went on a search to find the perfect snare drums for him, and I collected a ton of snare drums to find the one. Larry had one drum that Shelley used to play, that was Shelley's drum, this piccolo drum, which I have. I traded Larry for that, which that's that very. So they would record. There's only one snare drum. You know, a lot of movies you hear 4 guys playing snare drum or something like that. It was just there. It's like this one thing, but you have to be able to hear it because it's this ostinato thing that he always did in odd meters and stuff. And there was no baffles, so you had to play pianissimo, but where the sound, you could hear it, even with this heavy orchestra. And once I found the drums that he liked, he would say to me, "Steve, do you have my snare drum?" And I would say, "Yes, Jerry. Can I hear it?" He'd look at me like with a scowl and go, "Yeah, that's the one."
Yeah.
And so there was stuff like that, wow. You know. And I remember walking in on LA Confidential, and I came in with DeMonico, Chuck DeMonico, and I saw this part, and it looked like I couldn't hear it. When you look at something, if you can't hear what it sounds like by looking at it, you're not going to be able to play it. I always tell people,
yeah,
you have to be able to look at it and then have an idea what it sounds like. But it had the bass drums were never on the downbeats. The hi-hat was, I mean, whatever. He had this, he had a legend for this thing. It looked like one of these books that I never liked playing at, yeah. You know, and it was like, and I'm in there and Chuck DeMonico said to me, "Don't even bother, you know, just play what you want to." And I said, "Jerry likes what you play, just play what you want to." I said, "No, I can't hear this. I gotta figure." So like I'm figuring it out, and I managed to get through, maybe it was pretty long, maybe 20 bars. I got to maybe play 5 or 6 bars of it that I could play, and it was very awkward because nothing went the way my body moved with the drums, right. It was not drumistic.
Wow.
And so I'm there, and then the first thing, okay, we start the session, okay, people, Steve, can I hear, I wrote this drum part. He said, "Can you play this for me? I want to hear what it sounds like." And I look at Chuck DeMonico, who's like not looking at me. And so I started to play it, and I got through about 4 bars, and he goes, "You know, that sound, I don't like it. Just play what you want." Just, you'll hear it.
Yeah.
But I had to be able to play it for him to say that. And those are the words, you know, it's 10% nothing a lot of times, and then 100% terror when you have one of these kind of parts in front of you that you don't know what to do. I mean, or it's really written hard.
Yeah.
And so, I had that a lot of times with snare drum parts that were just from John Williams. I had the same kind of thing. I put one down on the part there. So that Kevin could see it, just even from here down where it says NFL, yeah, NFL. If you look at that part,
can I share the screen so people can see that?
If you want to, yeah, but it was okay. Like, yeah. I walked in on a session and that part.
Yeah, we're going to share the screen so you can see what we're all talking about here. This very complex drum part,
snare drum part.
There you go.
Yep.
And it was like very fast. And so, and 30 second notes going on. And I remember, so I play it and I, don't share it too long. I tell the story. I played it and John Williams said to me, and this is before we played any cue on this thing with, you know, a huge orchestra for doing the themes for the NFL. And I said, he said, "Are you playing single strokes or double strokes?" And I said, "Both." He said, "I just want single strokes." And if you look at the eighth note is at 167 beats.
That's freaking fast.
Yeah. And so I said, "Okay." But I knew how to play. I played it. But I had to use doubles occasionally because it's very, the 30 second notes, I mean, you can really wrong hand yourself. You'll be, you know, up the creek without a paddle, as they say.
Yeah.
And it was fine. But those are the kind of things, walking in, that's the terror, of not knowing. And the other times it's nothing, you know, it could be nothing, but you could walk in on something like this, and before the orchestra plays a note in a huge orchestra with a great composer, and then you have to look at something like that.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And so, anyway.
Wow.
You said something that you did the score for Arthur Rubinstein that was also really difficult.
Oh, my God.
Oh, really?
Yeah. I did the movie The Hard Way and Stakeout, both of his Stakeout movies. Mm. And he wrote out a part on the second Stakeout movie, and I couldn't play it. I mean, it was just, it looked like insanity. And so I didn't know what to do. And I told him, I said, Arthur, I don't know what this is. He says, oh, I just transcribed what you played on the last movie. I'm like, okay. But is there anything on the hard, no, there's no hard way there, right? Is there anything in my Apple Music? I don't have it in that playlist, so we'll have to pass on that for a second and just go on. But he wrote very, very difficult music, very difficult. Mm-hmm. And I had a lot of drum programming on those machines that you saw in the back room there. Mm-hmm. I had to be able to program and play, having that thing running and play.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
So it was really hair-raising. So where are we now? So where now we're out. Now I'm working.
Yeah.
Now I'm working. Now I'm working. So
and,
I
and
get
what
to
year
do,
is this now, would you say?
I have to look up the date for what now that we're gonna go on to.
Yeah.
Is Leatherheads in that same period?
No, Leatherheads, actually, let's see. I have
Mm, okay.
So yeah. I could tell that this is, you like this anecdotal thing. I get a call for Randy Newman. I love playing for Randy Newman.
Oh, yes.
The first movie I played on for him was a big band drumming in The Natural.
Mm.
Great film.
I shared some of the drumming with Alvin Stoller, and Jack Hayes was the orchestrator. Mm. Great writer.
Yes.
And I think Alvin was at Way, and so I got a call. And that was great. And so I started working for him. How are we doing time-wise, by the way?
Good. Okay. Yeah.
So I get a call and it said, okay, we're doing a movie about the NFL, the beginning of the national, about football in the 20s. So we need you to have a 1920 set of drums. I go, now, I know about that. As I told the listeners, growing up listening to the Hot Five, Louis Armstrong, I knew Zootie Singleton personally.
Yeah.
I listened to Baby Dodds play. They didn't have a bass drum. They had a bass drum player that played on 1920s. Later in 1924 was the first time a bass drum pedal was used on a bass drum. It was Gene Krupa was the first guy to record with that. And then things changed. So. Mm. As a student of history and drumming, as you are, Kevin, it was interesting. So I had a set of drums. I had a set of Gretsch drums that had all calfskin heads and the tom-toms, and they had a certain sound to them. And it wasn't a big bass drum or anything like with a light on it. You know, I had one of those drums in my first drum set, but it was good for those kind of movies where Randy always liked to play stylistically that kind of music.
Right.
And so they said, okay, so I set that and I had my regular drum set sent. And so the ones that are the Maple Customs were sent to that one.
Mm-hmm.
And not the gray ones.
Mm-hmm.
And I sent them, and of course, and I said, are you sure this is 1920s? They didn't have a hi-hat. They had a low boy.
Yeah.
And I said, even mid-20s, they did not have a hi-hat. So if you're thinking of that, that didn't exist then.
Yeah.
Had a little cymbal, you know, tacked on tom-toms, not tunable, almost like Chinese toms.
Right.
And I said, and most of it's snare drum, just playing on the snare drum, kind of a that style of music. He said, no, no. And so I get there, and I said, you sure it's not 1937, like Gene Krupa, you know, tom-toms and stuff like that? They said, no, it's 1920, so I still have the drums. So I get there, and just for the audience, almost every movie, before it's scored, they have a person who puts in music so that they can look at the music before they decide what they want to cut, before they hire a composer to write things for it, for an unfinished film. They put music to it so they can look at it and see how it sounds. And sometimes they fall in love with the music that they're playing. It could be classical music. It could be, you know, Benny Goodman, whatever it is that they put in that they think is period. The person who's doing this is usually not a musician, but could be. And in this particular case, the people were great. I mean, George Clooney was fantastic. He was the director. But I get there, and they play the music that had been that he'd been living with. And of course, it was Gene Krupa, 1937. So fine, I had my drums there. So I played one of the cues. It's Tiger Rag.
Yep.
And you'll see that was for the movie Leatherheads.
Okay.
And this is very drum heavy. This features Steve.
Yeah. Randy Newman.
Yeah. Randy Newman.
Yeah.
Gotta make it a little louder. Drums there.
Yeah.
It could play on the hi-hat and stuff, and they loved it, and the end result was fine, but it wasn't 1920s, you know. And 1920s would have been not right. It wouldn't have had the kind of energy they were looking for.
Right.
Drums were not dominant in those years.
Right.
It was, you know, it wasn't that kind of a thing. So anyway, just to
you said on the first digressing just a little bit off topic, but the first Arthur Rubinstein score that you did was together with Alvin Stoller, right?
No, the Randy Newman.
Oh, Randy Newman.
The,
yeah,
the new he wasn't on the session with me.
No,
but he had shared some of the big band stuff.
But you knew him personally.
Yes, I did.
What kind of man was he? Because I don't know much about
him. He was a really nice guy. He was a great drummer. I knew about him because I had I can remember the name of the drum record. It was just drummers. It had a guy, Dave Black, and it had Alvin Stoller.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember hearing it was Billy May, because he was Billy May's drummer.
Yeah.
Played on all the Sinatra stuff that was Billy May.
Mm-hmm.
I loved his drumming.
Mm-hmm.
I met him. I liked him so much as a person. We worked together. The first time we worked together, I was hired to play drums on a show called Fantasy Island.
Mm-hmm.
And I had my drums set up there, and I was hired to play drums. The next thing is the cartage company comes in and moves my stuff out and moves Alvin Stoller's stuff in. So now Alvin Stoller said, I'm playing drums because I'm not playing the mallet parts for this guy. So I'm going to be the mallet player with, this is great. So Elliot Kaplan wrote everything to a 24 frame click. So it was like, didn't matter what the tempo of the music was, because he could, you know, I mean, and you'd have to figure out how to play it. It was insane to play his music that way. But he always wrote just this one click, which was 24 frame click. So it was like, that was the click he used. That's the way his method was. So now I go over, and the way it wasn't like now where you had four parts where you could see all the percussion, and sometimes you could jump a line if you were playing orchestra bells. But you had, if you were percussionist, three or four. The first guy had his own part, the second guy had his own part, the third guy had his own part. And so now I have a part, and I'm playing orchestra bells to a triangle, no rest, 16th notes. I'm like, really? How am I going to do this? So, like, I just took the mallet from the orchestra bells and was like running to the play whatever else I was going to play, not knowing that there was a guy behind me coming to play the orchestra bells. If we had the part with staves where we could see, he would say, no, you just stay on the orchestra bells and I'll run over. So I go with the mallets because I have no time to put down the mallets, and I'm playing the triangle, and then the guy stops, Elliot stops the take and says, who's playing the bells at bar so-and-so? And it was Jerry Williams, John Williams' brother. Mm-hmm. And he looks at me, and he didn't say anything. Of course, he had no malice to play the part. And I said, oh, this is not good. I'm making a bad impression. But we both laughed about it, and we became really good friends. So,
Denver, that's you, Jerry Williams, and Alvin Stoller on that score.
Yeah.
Wow, that's amazing.
An episode.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, yeah, yeah, sure, yeah, sure. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
So, but it was funny. I think there was one other player, but I'm not sure. In those days, it wasn't a designated timpani player, so whoever sent the timpani usually played it, but you could wind up having to play anything, you know. You didn't know what you were going to get into.
Wow, amazing.
So okay. Wow. So now onward.
Yeah,
these are great stories.
Yeah, indeed. Wow.
Is it a little odd? I mean, maybe this is a little out of school for me to ask a question like this, but I think about it, I'm in my mid-40s and I'm from LA, and I've been playing on the scene over 20 years, and nowhere near anything like the studio stuff you've done, but some stuff over the years, and it's become more. But I find it odd to drive around LA and just look at the old locations, know that you did these cool things there. Do you have that kind of place memory about things you've done in Los Angeles around the years now?
Sure. You've been on the scene. Sure, because they closed all the scoring. They had a scoring stage at Disney.
Right.
That was the stage that actually Jerry Goldsmith was working on the day that Shelley died, when they had to let him know that.
Whoa.
There was a scoring stage at Universal that we worked at, stage 10. A lot of stories. We did all those Arthur Rubinstein stakeout movies. Any Universal movies were done there.
Yeah.
A lot of main titles. They had maybe 20 something shows a week for TV, with all these different writers. And
yeah.
So there were hilarious and great stories about all of those things.
Yeah.
And also, on the bands I played with, the stories are fantastic.
Yeah.
Right.
And I kind of missed the, I caught the tail end of like Monteleone's and Chadney's. I was a little too young to go to maybe Dante's and play that had closed by the time I was on the scene. But I have this this kind of dream that I'm like, I've had an actual literal dream where I'm going to play these clubs, that no longer exist.
Yeah, the clubs were fantastic. The
studios that are gone.
The studios were, they had, and every studio had had their own shows and different contractors. And so it was, you could make a living if worked at ABC. They had all these TV shows. So there were guys that played there, they worked all day, every day, doing these TV shows and things, and live shows. And the Joey Bishop show, had its own band. The Tonight Show had its own band here.
You said that you subbed in the Tonight Show band maybe once or twice, right?
No, I played. I played with Axe. I came in and played.
Oh, yeah, that's right. Yeah.
Yeah. I played with Tom Scott when he had a new record. And, you know, playing with Pat Williams. Well, I also met Tom Scott when he had the LA Express, because I subbed for John when they played with the band would play at the Baked Potato or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
I remember playing with Mac. I played with Max Bennett and then one gig with Larry Carlton and Mike Wofford, and I played at the Lighthouse. I don't know I don't know which band, but, and I used to work a lot with Victor Feldman and people like that.
Yeah.
So I have a picture there of the, you know, on the disc of the, Naris had a thing that was, I don't know why they stopped it, but they have a Naris Awards, the picture of the group of us who won 1 year. Do you see that there any place?
Why is the song?
No, those are just songs.
Yeah.
So it's in the it's,
I remember you sent it to us.
Yeah, so you want to see the email?
Yeah.
So go to the main, on the left next to the, there's a blue folder there on the, right there, you passed it. Yeah. And anyway, I know I put it in, I have another folder that I had on the desktop, but.
Okay. Well, yeah, just getting this going.
You know, it takes a while. I think we're at 38,000 unread emails.
By the way, thanks for joining us, everyone. We have some royalty here. Wonderful orchestrator, composer Nan Schwartz is with us right now.
Oh, fantastic.
Nan says, love the stories, Steve.
Yeah.
Okay. And, Dick Nash is here, the great Nash. Yeah.
Fantastic.
Yeah. Okay.
Oh. Okay. So, but there's a picture. If you, did I send it to you too? Or?
Yeah.
So just put your name in the
in
the search bar.
Yeah, that's it. One. Yeah.
Okay, so that does it have the group photo down below? Yeah. Okay, this one. Yeah, if you open that one, there it is.
Share the screen. You can all see what we're looking at. It's a very cool photo.
It was 1982.
Okay, so tell us who this.
So starting from left to right, left on the left side is Victor Feldman with a hat, then Chuck Berghofer on bass, he won, then David Duke, French horn player, then right in between Gail and David Duke is Sheridan Stokes, great flute player and teacher from UCLA, Gail Levant, Mike Melvoine next, who won an emeritus award, then me, then Claire Fisher, then Mike Boddicker, and then Paulino da Costa.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
And
incredible.
Yeah, so those were not all of us. Abe Lavoriel won on bass that year with me, which I have to digress because it was a really important part of my life was working with Abe. And when he first got here, we did spec projects and demos.
Mm-hmm.
We were not working very much. And I wound up in Herb Alpert's band, which I passed over, which was an important milestone because that was in 1974.
Yeah.
And, I later, after playing, I do have videos of that band just. I have a folder of them. Mm-hmm. And
share one of these?
Which one is it?
I got 1974 Vento Bravo and Legend of the One-Eyed
Sailor. Yeah, that's the beginning. That's where I got introduced. So you can just put on that one.
The Legend of the One-Eyed Sailor, yeah.
Okay.
So I can talk while this is happening. Yeah. So I was not working. It was it was before meeting Pat Williams mm-hmm. and all that. I had met Shelley, but I had, you know, I wasn't really doing much, and I was struggling, and I was divorced and not working. So I got the job. I auditioned for the job for Herb Alpert. It was supposedly 70 drummers that he had lined up at A&M Records, and they told me I was going to be number one. And I said, I don't really want to be number one, because when he gets to 40, he's not going to remember number one. Mm-hmm. And so, but I had no choice. So I auditioned. And after I auditioned or was playing, he canceled the rest of the guys. Like, and it was amazing. So I had this job.
Mm-hmm.
The deal was, you know, that we got a retainer, and I had a job. I could make a living. So there's a clip from 1974 when we went to England.
Mm-hmm.
There it is.
I'd like you to meet some of the TJB who are not the brass, some of the newest members of the group, the beat behind the brass. On drums, Mr. Steve Schaeffer. And from Cuba, on electric bass, Mr. Papito Hernandez. And here's one of our charter members. He's been with us from the beginning. Guitarist, composer, John Paisano. And on steel drum, and congas, and timbales, bongos, and smiles. A new addition to the sound of the brass, from St. Thomas in the Virgin Islands, Vince Charles. And on piano and organ, singer, composer, songwriter, Mr. Dave Frischberg. This is one of our newer songs, The Legend of the One-Eyed Sailor.
Chuck Finley
on Bobby trumpet? Finley.
Oh, Bobby Finley.
Yeah,
okay.
Bobby Finley, yeah.
And who's the trombone player?
Bob Edmondson.
Oh, okay.
And Julius Wechter on marimba.
Mm.
That's great.
So, so that band happened, and when it broke up, that's right before I went to New York and wound up getting the show Chorus Line.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Incredible. Well, it's been a couple hours.
Yeah.
And
we haven't got to my family though. I have to tell my.
You got to do your family stuff.
Yeah,
we
gotta
get you back for another part. If you join us again, because we still have so much to do, so much to cover.
Yeah.
I just want to you know, tell my my family, my beautiful wife Lisa, who helped me put together some of my bullet points. I think I jumped one of them, but and my in-laws hopefully are watching, and my son Seth, my son Andres, his wife Shana, the two babies, my daughter Megan in she's in Santa Fe, and my sister Ruth Ann, who's unfortunately in a rehab right now, but with all their support, I've had this incredible incredible life. I've been able to put my kids through school. I have a beautiful home and just a loving environment. So I'd love to do some more stuff. I mean, we haven't gotten through the 80s yet. So, but it would be great. But and to all my friends who are watching, love you much. And hopefully I'll see you again soon.
Yeah. I think what we should do is, because you have a trio with Russ Ferranti.
Oh, yeah, we need play. Yeah, I, a couple of things. I also,
great.
Is there any time to play like a bit of...
Along. Yeah,
yeah, I need to play also the track from Tom Rizzo's album.
Yeah.
Want to do that first?
Sure.
Okay.
We could do part, at least part of that.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's
because we started a little school late. Days. So,
yeah, it's ahead. Yeah. That's on the Apple playlist, right?
That's on the Apple playlist. Yes.
Days, right?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Tom and I, we played together. We rehearsed every Monday with Randy Allcroft's band. Mm-hmm. We became really good friends. He's also my financial consultant now. And he's an incredible. Well, and I worked with his wife Julie on most of all the movies I ever did. Mm-hmm. His wife was in the violin section, and I am grateful for my relationship with Tom. He's a great human being and an incredible writer and great guitarist, and we're still working on stuff together, so I look forward to those times too.
Yeah,
beautiful.
Yeah, Tom is great.
Okay, School Days, Tom Rizzo.
Such a nice vibe.
Yeah.
It reminds me a bit about Mancini.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, he does. He does. He does.
Yeah.
When I built this studio, originally it was just a MIDI studio that I was working with Tom Scott. I was part of a trio group. It was called, I don't remember what it was called, but it was. We got a movie called Hot Pursuit, and we did a TV show at Disney called it was like a miniature Karate Kid, and so I expanded the studio. I added this room, that room, and an office upstairs, and I had Russ came, and we were trying out stuff when I got the piano, and Rich Breen helped design some stuff here, and he designed everything actually, and got this patch bay put together, and other things. And I have a friend who worked for Rich named Aaron Walk, who's been working with me here, and we recorded this beautiful album that we did with Russell here.
Mm-hmm.
We started working here in 2011, but we didn't finish it until the pandemic.
You should play Isfahan.
Yeah.
Because Steve nice. Plays a solo on that. He plays a brush solo on that one.
Okay.
This is Russ Ferrante and Mike Valerio and Steve on drums.
Mike Valerio is a dear friend.
Yeah.
Well, love that guy.
Yeah, me too.
Rookie move. I'm a little fancy with my fade out.
Well, you could always fade out on the knob too.
Right.
Thank you.
as well.
Yeah.
So I forgot about a couple of important footnotes, like what happened, how Rise happened, the song.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. Herp.
Yeah.
Well, that's going to be part of part two. Okay. Herb and Eddie Daniels Tom Scott and Dave Frischberg. And
yeah, I never did find the tracks to Getting Some Fun Out of Life. Did you ever find it?
No, but I'll make sure that we'll have that the next time.
Okay. Sounds good.
great interview, Steve.
Yeah.
Thank you so much.
Oh, you're welcome. Wow. I want to hear, ask me questions about the movies that you like.
That will be next time.
Yes.
I have to do more homework on your incredible list of films that you played on.
Because there's some great stories on those things.
Yes. Yeah. Absolutely.
Too much for one.
Yeah. Okay.
And thanks for sharing your beautiful studio with us.
Yeah,
too.
Well, we'll do that here again. You know what to do now, right?
Yeah, exactly.
You got it hooked up.
Yeah, I'll leave the access thing in my preferences for you to call it.
Plug and play now.
Yeah, plug and play. Perfect.
Well, thanks everybody for joining, and thanks so much to the legend Steve Schaeffer for this the super amazing and inspirational interview, man. Like, you're just a class act.
Yeah. Well, thank you so much.
Yeah,
really appreciate Steve being here. Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Thank you
to all my friends.
Yep.
Thanks everybody.
Thank you. See you next time.